You're watching Hornbill TV. Like we have mentioned in all our social, Robin Hibo, IPS now.
Today we're going to discuss about various issues that needs to be discussed intensely, and which is also a need of the hour. We're going to discuss about welfare and support for students studying outside Northeast India, and also various other issues concerning our brothers and sisters studying outside Northeast India or living outside Northeast India. And today to discuss about that, we have a very special guest with us. We have Sir Robin Hibo. He's an IPS and also the Special Commissioner of Delhi Police. He's also a two-time President Medalist, two-time State Level Medalist, and also two-time UN Medalist, and the list goes on. So maybe it will just take, you know, the whole day if you just mention about all the achievements that he has. So thank you so much, sir. We understand that you have a very busy schedule, but thank you so much for, you know, taking out time and agreeing to talk to us today.
Thank you, Atu. I'm very glad to be in your Hornbill TV. Hello to all Nagaland viewer of your popular local TV.
It's a pleasure to have you, sir.
Yeah, me too. Okay.
Sir, so before we begin with our questions, would you like to share a few words of your stay in Nagaland as a young IPS officer?
Okay, ma'am. Bring me a very good nostalgic memory. My first starting career as a young IPS under trainee, I was attached as a district or exposure training in Kohima and Junnabutto. So that was in 96-97. So I still remember very vividly. I stayed in MLA cottage, I played badminton, we went all around, I enjoyed it so, even more than my home, because the food stuff were more or less like what I like most. Still, the akuni is my favorite, you know. I like it. And plus, at that time, I used to go to church. I used to, you know, meet people. We used to visit the village. And what I like most of that time is that, you know, whatever people may say from outside world, I really had a great, or I would say very personal hospitality, which, you know, every Naga, either in market or in a shop or in a village or in an MLA cottage or even in the Raj Bhavan, even in your secretariat, that really made me very, very, I feel at home. It's something that still I cherish. And that's what I always say. I still have a very, I would say, fun memory, and it is still fresh in my blood. So anybody from Nagaland, you know, it attracts me that there's somebody very close to my heart. Yes, Atu?
Yes. Seems like you had so much fun when you were here, sir. So, sir, again, you are also the founder of Helping Hands NGO. So you, as a social worker and also an IPS officer, how do you balance those two duties together in times as such?
Atu, I want to tell you one thing. Look, I am from a very, very humble background. In my village, there was no water, no electricity, no road. So even I had only one teacher who, you know, taught me from class 1 to class 7. And in between, I went for 2 years in the Don Bosco School in Tezpur in Assam. That's a different issue. So I'm from a very humble background. I know what it means to be a student from a humble background.
Yes, sir.
Going to city for higher study, and you are, you know, virtually you are like a lamp in the Jurassic Park. So I know what it means to suffer, to be humiliated, to be discriminated.
Yes, sir.
And that's what, by God's grace, today I'm in a good position. Then I thought, okay, why not give something back to our people, not only to Arunachali, but also to all our Northeast people, because I know the problem which we face is very, very unique and different. And our vulnerability is very high, which many of them, they have no understanding of our issues.
Yes.
So that's what I know. It's a very busy schedule being an IPS officers. But still then, something which you love from your heart, I think you do it with love, then that is not an issue. So from my very day one I joined, Atu, I want to tell you, just to inform you, I helped even in my first pay from the orphan boy. They become engineer now. Now also, apart from helping, and I have given my ancestral house for a library in the village. I am running a small clinic in the village where all the tribal elders can come and take medicine free of cost, apart from helping in. So having a very busy schedule, and I think if anyone, whoever he or she may be, if you are really willing to do something which you love, as I said, and it, of course, for that, you have to experience those pain, trauma, discrimination, then only you can understand. So being from that background, so I can relay my, you know, my childhood struggle in college days in Delhi, and my struggle even in the National Police Academy, even as even in UN. So all these things made me more close, or I would say more, I would say akin to the problem faced by our people in cities. Mm-hmm. And we are more or less like, you know, as I said, that our people from Northeast are more or less like a lambs or deer in the Jurassic Park in the city for various reasons. So this is a very challenging job, running NGO also as well as my job. So that's, I feel, it's a privilege for me. God has somewhere or other in our voice called me out, kid, you, I have to do something. That's what I'm carrying on. Atu?
Yes, so in there we can say that we Northeast people are not just proud of who you are, but we're also, we'll also be forever grateful for whatever you have done for the Northeast people, sir. So moving forward and coming to the serious part of the discussion, I would like to ask if there's any data that will inform about the number of Northeast students studying outside, or, you know, people living outside Northeast India or in the metropolitan cities like Delhi, Mumbai or Bangalore as such.
First of all, since I'm Delhi-based officer,
yes,
so
sir,
my first priority is Delhi and
yes,
NCR.
Sir.
NCR means Ghaziabad, you know, Gurgaon, Noida, and Faridabad.
Yes.
So here we have around 10 to 11 lakhs of Northeast people, the idea,
yes,
including student employees and, you know, those who are even floating, you know, employee who are working in here.
Yes.
And in Mumbai, we have around 1.5 lakhs of people are there, more or less.
Okay.
And Bangalore is the second highest, almost 3 to 4 lakhs people are there. So the maximum, you know, the populations of the Northeast people are in the cities are in Delhi and NCR. So that's a great challenge. And that's what it gives me an opportunity to serve our people where I have the maximum population from the Northeast. Yes, Atu?
So also when in times as such, what are the common cases that requires intervention from the administration of the police authorities?
This is a very, very vast subject, but I would like to very precisely just let you know, all the viewers, look, the problems are massive, but I would categorize it into a few head. Number one, problem related to employees from the Northeast.
Yes, sir.
Many a time, reveal this one also, that 90% of our Northeast people who are in cities are in private unorganized sector. So here is the greatest challenge for us. Lack of non-payment of salary, delayed salary payment, sexual harassment in the workplace, just throwing them out without any notice and without giving them opportunity to go higher in their career, no training avenues for them. And even, you know, sometimes a very mind-boggling case of, you know, putting them in a very, very, I would say, embarrassment kind of a job once they are in the private sector. That is on the employees, notice employee-related problem, number one. Number two, student-related problem. The student-related, we have lakhs of students are, you know, all over the country. Here, the problem, we are many, but major problem are like discrimination they face it in their campus,
yes, sir,
outside the campus. Many a time, even during this corona time, you might have heard, you might have read, even we are called as a corona in many places. You know?
Yes, sir, true.
Then there is a rent issues. By seeing our face, they think that we are a foreigner, Japanese or Chinese, or this, that. They rake up the rent, patobala charge you more, the shopkeeper, yes, they will charge you more. So then apathy of the sometimes in the authorities, like in the university or college, even the police, even in the administration, they don't have that sensitivity. Then,
yes,
apart to add the problem more, they can't speak Hindi. Maximum from Nagaland, from Mizoram,
yes,
and Meghalaya, they are not able to speak Hindi. That makes them more vulnerable. So this is the student-related problem. Then third problem faced by the Northeast is the entrepreneurs from the Northeast. The problem they face is that most of the time, our people are by nature very gullible. We believe everybody. We think all world is heaven. Everybody is good. So they are cheated many a time after the agreement or after paying the money. Then the MOU is not being carried out. The advance is given. So the entrepreneurs are left to fend themselves, finding no one. We have so many cases, even our ex-minister, even many educated people, they paid money, but the business which they promised, they signed an MOU, they could not carry it out. So this is related to the entrepreneurship-related problem.
Okay.
Then another problem, I would like to say that we have a cyber fraud. This is something, it's very worrisome for our police and even for our notice. I have been constantly uploading it into our social media. How our notice states have become, I would say, the gold mine for the, you know, this cyber crime. You know, I would like to quote how many of our girls and boys, especially the ladies, have been duped by the so-called, you know, sending a gift from London, from Washington, from this, from that, with that handsome hunk, sending the photograph, then saying my gift is stranded in Delhi airport or Mumbai or Chennai. Please send the money. Then somebody will call in a fake custom officer will call up for the custom clearance, this, that. That is one. Secondly, that we have so many cases of, you know, falling in love in the cyber world. And many of them, they came down up to Bangalore, up to Delhi. Even from Arunachal, we had a case. They came down up to, you know, Noida. Somewhere or other, we had been hallucinated in that cyber world. Then we have another, what is called cyber-related problem, that we have a massive, I would say, from some African countries, some of our are in touch with this, what is called, they are living in cities, especially in Delhi and Mumbai. We have still many girls, they are still in lockup. There's still many girls, notice girls also wanted by the police. They are with them, and with the help of these cyber things, they will allow their passbook or bank account or ATM to be used for the depositing the, you know, the black money. So this is another really worrisome trend for our notice girls. Then, I want to again bring to your notice skill-telling related problem. I appreciate the skill training is one of the, of course, the very good intention to, you know, to skill the youngsters and so that they can make their bread and butter in life. But somewhere or other, you know, the problem we face it every day, the problem which I see, which they come to me with the tears in their eyes, is that we, after the training, skill training is over, they are, you know, I would say that many of this so-called employer or hire company, they will fly down to Koima, Itanagar, Imphal, or Gangtok, and they will promise heaven with, you know, the very showy in a good best hotel in Koima or Itanagar or in Imphal. And they, unfortunately, what our analysis indicated, they generally take all those young females who are good-looking, tall, good in speaking, they take them out, and they wonder, we have cases, many cases, I can go on court, I want to cut short, we have many cases where they are brought here, and they have been put, not together, but in a different hotels or in a different locations. So they are not allowed to communicate each other also. Then become more vulnerable. And as a result, since they have left home, spent so much of money from the parents, so the girls and boys, they can't go back home also. Having said that, once they are employed in the cities, they are like, again, I repeat this word, they are like a lamp in the Jurassic world. There is no follow-up from our home state government. There is no institution which is following them up, whether these boys and girls whom you have given the job, whether they are doing well or not, whether their payments are made in time, whether they are given the adequate raise as per, you know, the rule, whether they've been given an opportunity to promote, to go ahead in their hierarchy, whether there is a job security or not. So as a result, after initial euphoria of 2 years of giving you a job, then you are at the mercy of the employer, especially in an unorganized sector. Yes. There is the greatest challenge which I see it. So many a time, you know, you will be shocked to hear our females are, you know, asked to wear a particular dress, go to other city to promote the business We have so many, I can't even narrate you in this video conference, in this interaction. So that is another area. Then as a result, they, after 1 or 2 years, they are in the mercy of the, this employer. Then they say either you have to obey us or you have to, you have to stagnate or you have to go back.
Okay.
Then harassment starts.
Okay.
So as a result, many of our girls, they have gone back. Many of our boys, they are in the, you know, in the scam company. Because we don't, even there is no backup system to verify the job, job which they are getting after skill training, in whether it is registered or not, whether it's a legal company or not. I think recently, so many Naga boys and girls are in the fake, you know, BPO companies. Many of them are in jail in Noida, in Rajasthan, in Delhi. So it is because of daily routine. So the skill training is one of the gray area. The last point, Madam Atu, I want to tell you that the vulnerability of the note is female. I know it is a very sensitive issue, but since the problem comes to me to a helping hand, so I want to just say it in a diplomatic way. Number one, we appreciate, we are not against anybody having any relationship. Fine, that's, we have no objection. But since the the problem which we see every day, we face it, that if you are falling in love, very good. It's the greatest God gift of God. But please fall in love with the blessing from your parents, from your church, from your community, from the get a marriage in the court, and ensure that in your marriage paper that your name is entered in the property list, in the service book list, so that tomorrow if something happens, you are at least secure from all angles. I have so many cases, I don't want, even from Nagaland, many, many cases, they were just as a hallucinated so-called pyar ho gaya, go to temple, put some sindur here, and promise in the church, and they will just live life like that, and after a few years, they're thrown out. I have many cases, so many dangerous aborigines, so many have died, we have buried many of them. So this is one another area, I told you, these are the problems we face it that is in the cities. Atul?
So thank you so much, sir, for your information. That was not just informative, but also, you know, it was like an awareness for our viewers also.
Yeah.
So I want to ask regarding the, you know, recent case where one of our sisters committed suicide. So is there any update on or lead on that issue?
Look, ma'am, since this is a police case, and I've already spoken to the, you know, to the top cop of the Rajasthan, they are on the job. They say they are on the job because the mobile where the data were yet to recover. There are many other issues, and I think it will be inappropriate to discuss because it is related to some of his personal life of that our sister, Lobikali Sumi also. So it won't be. But I can only tell you that already I've spoken to the to the DCP, to the DGP, to the even to the SHO. So I have told them, and I am also personally monitoring that justice is done to her. So in that case, we are, from our legal point of view, whatever needs to be done, as a NGO, as a well-wisher of our sister who is no more, she had other domestic problems also. I don't want to narrate in the open forum. That is one. And second is that, look, we have the reason which you have asked is that why they are committing suicide, which you have indirectly hinted.
Yes, sir.
Atu, you know, it is as I said, in the you might have observed in the evening time, if there is a bulb on the street light, moth, they always go there and go there and attract in that white, you know, with lonely, you know, I would say, electric bulb, you know. So something like that, it is happening. There is a lure of fake good light. I repeat, the lure, L-U-R-E, lure of fake good light in cities. They have no idea that how hard the cruel the city lives are. So as a result, that this illusion, the hallucination of better life from their home in the cities, that is one of the reasons of our why when they come out from your Nagaland or Arunachal or Mizoram, wherever from they come out, when they find the reality is very, very cruel and harsh, you are left alone, you are vulnerable, then you feel ki there is, you are misfit in that society. I'm not against coming to city and doing well. Why not? There are so many good people doing so well, you know. Of course, they come with full preparation. I mean to say, a doctor, a professional, a businessman. They come out with a lot of homework being done before they reach this Jurassic cities. So they do their homework, they survive, like Nagaland Kitchen, Dr. Lira. We have so many of them are doing so well in their, you know, profession. So that is one. Second is that our culture mooring is different. Our food habit is different. We look different.
Yes, sir.
So it is very difficult in the initial stage to adjust with the lifestyle of the mainland people. Like I'm giving an example, like in most of the Delhi, we have, except for New Delhi, other part of Delhi is more like rural Haryana or UP village. And their lifestyle is different, food habit is different, way of life is different. So you become a contrast, you know, like just out of water. Then to add the more problem more, you're having no knowledge about the vernacular language. If you are in Mumbai, if you do not know Marathi, you are, or Hindi, you are almost like a, you know, foreigner in the plan. So all these things combinedly, and of course, as which I told you earlier, that harassment in the workplace, getting a very less pay, you have no connection with your family member, you can't go to church, you can't go to for community meeting because your job is in the most of the private sector. What they do is they will explore, they will take your maximum work at least 12, 11 hours in the night time, except on Sunday they call the meeting. So that lack of social interaction with your fellow community members, and lack of, you know, that entertainment, all these things together, they tend to, some of them tend to take some substance which are destructive to their body. They tend to keep aloof. Then they tend to go into depression. And I want to give an example, like one very young boy from Meghalaya. Before he committed suicide in Agra, he sent me WhatsApp. He said, "My life is doomed. I cannot survive. So goodbye. I know. Thank you so much. What you are trying to do for us." So there are so many cases, but I can't reveal it.
Yes,
many boys, many girls, they come. And still, you know, and here we'll later part we'll discuss. They feel even in such crisis or in such kind of emotional disbalance time, you have no one. Take home many a time. You can't call all the time your mobile. If you're lucky enough in Kohima or Dimapur, fine, you can contact. But if you are in Paran or in some remote village like Amini in Arunachal or in Lungle in Mizoram, you can't even reach out your mobile number. So you are completely, you know, left alone in this Jurassic city. So that makes you to take your life sometimes. They can't bear that loneliness, the depression, hopelessness in their life. Yes, Atu.
So also adding to that, what I've noticed is when we notice in people, we go out and study outside the state, our own state, what we do is we try to search for our own people and we mingle with those people only. We don't try to, you know, besides some, like, you know, there are some who, you don't even try to get out of the comfort zone and try to get to know other people when you are living in that other part of the city. So you have to try to understand that their culture as well, what their food habits as well. So what do you think about that, sir?
This was, you know, one of the reasons I brought out one booklet when I was in a young DCP of the Delhi police. You know, like I'm from Arunachal. So you are rightly pointed out, you know, I was about to tell you on this issue. We cannot blame only to the cities also. You know, you should also have that art of surviving in this Jurassic city. For that, you know, like I am here in Delhi for last 12 years. Imagine, I am continuously serving in Delhi. Means I am doing well. That's what government is not, you know, they're not sending me out, they're keeping here only. So you are rightly pointed out. Many of the what you said is very, very true. Like I'm from JNU and GU. Most of the time, I always tell this word in addition to what you said. You are an ambassador of your state in city.
True.
Whatever you do, you reflect Naga culture, Mizo culture, or Arunachal. If you are behaving well, if you're doing well, if you are, you know, I would say adjusting in that society, then you become a role model. So here I advise, means as elder brother, I tell all our people, number one, participate in their festival also. In the Ballabali of the Punjabi, in the Holi of the Punjab, of the mainland.
Yes,
you
sir.
Invite them during our Christmas, to during our Good Friday, or during Bihu, or during our, you know, festival of Naga, Mijo, whatever you may be. So if you intermingle, if you learn the language, And if you participate into their social cultural activities, then automatically you will also be accepted. And that's what I encourage in Delhi also, in many of our, in our interaction with our Northeast organizations and community leaders. See, look, you are living here and doing business. You have to participate in the Mohalla Committee or RW, Resident Welfare Committee, or a market association. You must contribute. You must take active part. Then you should become a member of that market welfare association or resident welfare committee or even Mohalla committee. Then only you will be accepted. Then only you will be given more responsibility. So this is very, very true. And apart from that, I say, if somebody mistreat you or if you do not know, if somebody tried to humiliate you, we should take it in a positive way. I always say this word, everybody is not bad. Yeah, look, I'm here. Yeah, I'm getting support. I'm getting support for running, helping, and not from our Northeast people, but from the mainland people. They are giving so much of support for rations during the last lockdown time. We have got almost 40 trucks of rations from the whole mainland. Yeah, we didn't get anything from our back home, except for a few individuals donating here and there. So you have to spread out your hand, shake hand with them, smile with them. Of course, maintain that boundary. Do not let your smile be again take advantage. You are easily available. So having said that, we need to adjust wherever you are, learn the language, share in the into their cultural mooring festivals and so forth. Then above all, if somebody tries to mistreat you, smile. And I always say this example. I always do carry the India map in on my pocket. If somebody tried to humiliate, oh, you are from Nepali, Badur. I smile and say, I let them see the map and see. This is called Northeast. Here it is called Arunachal, and I belong. Since I can speak a fluent Hindi, so they are shocked. So, yes, so as a result, you know, I could survive. Yes, Atu?
This is also, with that, we can also put forward the message that just because we are, you know, trying to mingle with people doesn't mean we are forgetting our culture and, you know, adopting another culture, but it's give and take. We can say that, right, sir?
Exactly, exactly.
So also talking about, you know, when we see a lot of our Northeastern youngsters committing suicide also, just like we have mentioned before. So is there any, you know, professional assistance, you know, to cater to them?
Atu, that I would say from our side, helping hand, we are, yes, we have a counselor with our helping hand. We have our professional counselor. We are trying to do counseling from our side and do whatever we can do that. Apart from that, there is no institutional, what is called, arrangement for this kind of counseling and so on and so forth. So here I want to just bring it to your, what is called knowledge. The Bejborua Committee Recommendation of Government of India, where I provide MHA, where I was also a member, there we have given an elaborate recommendation, including this counseling and so on and so forth for the Northeast people in the cities. So I can only say that, like in Delhi, at least we have started it with our, we have raised the Delhi police for Northeast region. There we have our special helpline 1093. We have our special recruitment from the police. Beyond this, we don't have as such, and I think that is really worrisome. I think that is something which we all, like a donor or NEC and even the state government, should have a proper liaisoning, do a analysis of this issue with the Bhavan, with the donor ministry, with the NEC, with the NGOs, with the women commissions, and with the student leader. Then we can have, there is a lot of scope to do that. I am happy that you have raised this issue, because if something has happened, there is no one. Either they'll send WhatsApp message, Robin sir, goodbye, I am taking my life. Or they'll say, I will do this, do that. So many a time, since we don't have that that institutionalization of this counseling system, so that is a very major challenge which we are also facing. Yes, ma'am. Yes,
sir. So when we talk about mental illness, it's still something that we don't discuss much about. People still see it as taboo. So when you work with helping hands to, you know, students and youngsters actually come and approach?
Look, Atu, those who are having problem, we have studied that almost more than 100 cases. Some of them have committed suicide, some of them have survived. The problem here is that these vulnerable sections are left alone. So sometimes they are not proactively reaching out to their community also.
Yes,
first, they don't want, you have rightly pointed out, they don't want to expose themselves that you are having mental problems. So you people will say, to pagla manual. So they will not like to expose themselves.
Yes,
so in confidential, they've sent many SMS and WhatsApp, I get it. And we don't reveal those name by name. We arrange what is called special counseling. So here I feel there is a problem. Here, you should more focus on what are the solutions which we can think of.
Yes,
church can play a very vital role.
Yes,
all
sir,
those
sir.
Pastors preach and other, whenever in every church service you can emphasize on to coming out of that dark zone. You should not have kind of that feeling that you are different or you feel ashamed. Second, civil society. We have so many civil societies back home. I think apart from doing the normal, social work, this is one key area we all can think of, have a confidential, like what we are doing experimentation for last 2 years. We have a confidential, what is called counseling doctors from AIMS. They are doing on voluntary basis. Then we send out this message. We reach out, what we do is now, because we had made those vulnerable section of the people, like in Delhi and NCR. What we found is that maximum those who are committing suicide, 80% are working in unorganized sector, number one.
Yes, sir.
Number two, they are not connected with your church member or your community group or in any other social. They are more or less left out, job, home. So what we have done is that we had a survey, indirect survey to our volunteers, like, where are these girls and boys are staying together? We have at least 5 pockets we have identified. Munirka, Khirki Extension, like Mukherjee Nagar, Sunlight Colony, Burari, like that. So all those areas, what we do now is that our volunteers, because generally most of them are girls, so we, of course, boys are also there, we drop them a pamphlet. This is helping him. We will not reveal anything. If anybody is facing any harassment, anybody who is facing any kind of emotional turmoil which they want to convey, we have a professional doctors whose your name will not be revealed. And I think that is really helpful. That word spread. There is someone who can tell us. So backing what this experiment can, I think, replicated. This is what I tell the Women Commission from Nagaland, from Mizoram, even from Arunachal, even Manipur. Look, this counseling, we are doing so many awareness. This awareness is a very routine way. Now, I advise and I give suggestions that now you should focus on what is required by the girls of our Nagaland or from Arunachal. Please, back home, you have everything. You have state government, you have a family member, you have a church. I always say this word. Our notice people have forgotten their brothers and sisters who are in cities. We have student union, no doubt.
Yes, sir.
But they have very limited resources or time, number one. Number two, though we have a Bhavan in Delhi, but Bhavans are, it very well, they are already very busy and their resources and every manpower are very limited. So here, I want to give suggestion that it can be a great challenge. We can, I would say a wake-up call for our people too, in this mental, counseling for our people. Yes, Atu?
So also I want to ask, when it comes to cultural sensitivities of Northeast people or when dealing with issues concerning us, are the, non-Northeastern authorities like the Delhi police or the Mumbai police, how aware are they? Or how, are they well informed?
Okay. Number one, look, it's a fact that many of people, including an official level, they don't have much idea on Northeast. They only know, that is Mary Kom or Bhupen Hazarika or Alobo Naga or some here and there. So the we can't blame them also. This what I always say, this word. You should study from the other side of the story also, because we need to have a more exposure of NCRT. We need to have a more television exposure, social media,
yes,
in the TV channel. And I always say this word, let there be more tourists come to our notice. But unfortunately, we don't have a good road. I am told the Nagaland and Itanagar road are the most popular road because of potholes. Anyway, that's joke apart. So having said that, there is, yes, you are right, there are many a time they are not aware of this. So like in Delhi police, I can give a very good example. Here, we are making the mandatory sensitization on notice issues to the Delhi police by the notice, you know, lecturer, I mean to say, officers, including me. We give a sensitization to our Delhi police jawan that these are the eight sisters, these are the culture more. Even we dance, even in my time when I was in charge, even we have conducted a notice dance for our Delhi police. So they let them know this is Naga dance, this is a Mijo bamboo dance, this is a, you know, Assam's in the Diu dance. So that it is a massive way. Delhi police, we are more or less, I can tell you very confidently here, at least we are many of the almost everybody is aware of our problem. But other states, what we do need it more. Like in Delhi, apart from the sensitization, we had a special recruitment,
yes,
from the Northeast. Almost around 2,700 plus boys and girls in the Delhi police. You know, we had a special recruitment from all of the Northeast. I had a lot of Naga boys. They are in the commandos. It feels very good. So here we do need more. Here again, I want to refer, even in the, again in the Desh Barua committee, it was again recommended for, you know, have a notice recruitment from other states also, so that, you know, we will have notice policemen in Mumbai, Bangalore, Chennai, Goa, you know, and that is a recommendation. I think if it is implemented, that can be a really long way in sensitizing the issue of our problem in the police and in other authority. Yes, ma'am.
So as we know, media, when it comes to media is not just you know, a mode of information, but also a mode of awareness and education as well. So what do you think the mainland media can do to cater to our Northeastern people or to sensitize, you know, the mainland Indians about our culture?
Regarding media exposure, you know, I'm very many a time I raise this with the in a different forum in Delhi also. Okay? We are shown as a dancing with a you know, with a dao in around the fireplace with a semi-naked dress. That is not our notice. It's one of our folk dance. Okay, we appreciate. So you know, I feel there is a wrong portrayal of the notice in the many of the in the mainland media. You know, we have so many other good things to tell. Loktak Lake, Jukku Valley, you know, the Second World War, the graveyard of the Kohima, or, you know, that largest church of your Junobuto, you know, the Asia's largest church. We have our Tawang, we have our Cherrapunji, you know, all these things are, I would say, we need to, not only in the mainland media, because what I'm telling you is that people, only elite people see that this mainland, like NDTV, HT, or Times Now. What I am proposing and what I am suggesting to every media agency, please, we must show it to the vernacular local media of the mainland.
Yes, sir.
Say, like in UP, which the most of the common people they see, there they should show all these things. And that, yes, we need to more. And there also it makes a more like media like from the Northeast. Yes. Hardly you come out and have an interaction with the mainland media. Every year we have annual media day these days. Except for Patricia Mukhiam and your one of the writer from Nagaland, we hardly see anybody, you know, coming out and, you know, standing for the notice.
Yes,
so I think as a media, you should also come out and take an innovative way of telling our side of the story. We don't really only drum and guitar only. We have many beautiful things to show also.
Yes, the truth.
Yes, for that, we need, like I was telling you, need to upgrade your communication system, you need to upgrade, you need to have a good airport, you need to have a good road, and that will automatically attack the people. So here comes, only the awareness is not going to help you. You need to learn example from Sikkim. They don't propagate. They have a good road, they have a good air connectivity. People are peaceful, no law and order. So everybody is going there. So every in the last year report, 80% of the tourists who are going to North East are there prefer to go to Sikkim because of all this factor.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Atu.
So coming to, since we know that COVID-19 is, you know, the issue these days, so talking about it, so I would like to ask, when you working in Helping Hands, when a person tests positive, so how do you take care of that? How do you go about with that procedure?
Number one, we had a two-phase of COVID crisis. Like last year, we had a lockdown all over
yes,
the
sir,
country.
Yes, sir.
There, our Helping Hand, we had we had a massive ration control room for Delhi and NCR. We had a two tier of response of ration for our Northeast people. One was for the Delhi NCR region. We had a control room. We had a distribution team. We had a packing team, and we had a team to manage the donations and so forth. So it ran very well. So last year we had 1,76,000 ration we have distributed. We are thankful to the NEC also. They gave us 30 lakhs of rupees for the ration distribution. Also, many of the good people, I always say this word, kon kehta hai Delhi walon ko pa dil nahi hai. They all came forward and help us in a lot of way. That is one, and that is for Delhi and we did not allow anyone to go without food. That is for Delhi and now for other part like Mumbai, Delhi, Mumbai, Calcutta, Goa, Agra, Jammu, Jaipur. For that, again, we had that second strategy was connecting the dot. Since I belong to the IPS officer, so I call up all my batchmates, IAS and IPS all over the country and requested them to be the nodal officer for the notice COVID management in their respective state.
Yes,
like Kuldeep Ranka from Rajasthan, Arunachal IAS officer Indra Malo from Arunachal in Maharashtra. So like that, we had this connecting dot. What we did, the model was every morning by 9 a.m., we used to get a list of two lists. One list is for Delhi. These are the stranded people who need rations. So within 2 hours, we fan out in Delhi with 8 vehicles, fanning out north and south. We distribute the rations for each and everyone. We inform them through their WhatsApp that we are coming. So for all over the country, we used to give the list of the stranded notice people in Lucknow or in Goa or in Chennai or in Bangalore to that nodal officer, either he is a commissioner or secretary or a IGP or of the police. So what he did was that he will connect it to the district DC and SP and relief of that particular area. So they include our notice stranded people also in that list, and food and rations are distributed where distributed. So I'm really thankful to my batchmates for connecting the dots. Now coming to the present COVID, the crisis you might have heard, you might have seen is oxygen,
yes,
bed, plasma, blood, and medicine.
Yes.
The most urgency was oxygen, where everybody was not getting. There was hue and cry. So after this second wave, we found the hospital seats were full. So many of the thousands of our notice people were also infected. Many died also. So they started looking out for oxygen. I'm not talking about oxygen for the doctor in hospital. For hospital, they somewhere or another they had managed. I'm talking about the Northeast COVID patients who were quarantined in their respective homes and their oxygen level fluctuated down below 92, which is a very dangerous, you know, if you go down below 92, you may die at any time because of lack of oxygen. So everybody reached us out to Helping Hand, to in our social media group, in my mobile, in WhatsApp group. He said, do something. We are not getting any oxygen from anywhere. That set us thinking, and we started oxygen ATM. We beg, borrow, and steal. Of course, stealing doesn't mean illegally stealing from others. We left no stone unturned. We went up to the Meerut, to the Rajasthan, to the Faridabad to get oxygen, even standing the whole night from the different sources. So we collected a huge number of oxygen, what is called cylinder. So we opened one ATM in the Subhash Nagar in the Delhi, where the volunteers for our Helping Hand volunteer, they were manning it. So we had, since I was more than 4,000 plus people were asking for, you know, this oxygen from the Northeast. So I had all their numbers. I made a WhatsApp group. So we flashed them, okay, now I have oxygen ATM. If anyone is having an oxygen cylinder, please come and you send me your address, your doctor prescription of your COVID. We will allot you a digitally number. And you show that number to the policeman and go to the ATM and you take the ATM, take the oxygen. If you have your own cylinder, you collect it into your cylinder and go home. If you don't have an oxygen cylinder, we will give you an oxygen cylinder, but you have to return. So like that, we deliver. And those the managed, I think, then the third point is that those who do not, lonely ladies or lonely girls, you know, living in some rented house, no vehicle, nothing, no friend, to them, we even deliver our oxygen to them by our ambulance. Because we have even ambulance also. Okay. Even we deliver a medicine. So this is how we manage the oxygen kind of thing. Number two, for a bed, we had a tie-up with the Six Sigma, and we have 54 hospitals were already in a tie-up with our helping, and they were giving concession for the medical concern for the notice. So the nodal officer, we were in a constant touch. So we somehow or other, through our connection, through our request, push everybody somewhere or other. If it is from Delhi, South Delhi, we'll push them in the max. If it is from North Delhi, we'll request to the St. Stephen Hospital. So somehow it was like a war-like situation. So this control room of oxygen ATM, it is still going well. I'm very happy. And I'm really thankful to, you know, people who have really, who came out, you know, donated their own oxygen cylinder. Some of our, even Maricom gave 3 lakhs. Your Nagaland Commission, Women Commission Chairperson gave 50,000, you know, like that. Even
yes,
I started with my 50,000 from my own salary in the initial, in the month of the March. So this is how we are tackling. Then apart from this, Atu, you must know, there are many notice people who are willing to have a consultation, medical consultation, not only COVID, even non-COVID patient. Yes. So many a time, since hospital is closed, full lockdown, or lockdown means hospital is totally dedicated for the COVID. So other disease, where they will go? And even those who are home quarantined, they need a consultation, right? Consultation means this has happened, this has happened, what is the next step, or so and so forth. Though there was a lot of helpline by the government, for the Delhi government and other, but most of them speak in Hindi, so they could not communicate properly. So what we did again, we look out for our notice doctors, right? Here, I want to really acknowledge one of the very dynamic Naga doctor, Dr. Leela Santam from Safdarjung Hospital, exceptionally 24/7, giving a counseling to the COVID patients, to the non-COVID patients. Then Mr. Jamo from Arunachal Pradesh, from ESI Hospital, Madam Sharma from Delhi, Nijantale from Ramanand Hospital, then Dr. Sonam from Sikkim. We have 5 doctors, 24/7, for any notice, already uploaded into the social media. They know that if you have any problem related to the what is called COVID or non-COVID issue, you can consult them. We have 3 ladies and 2 gentlemen doctors. So this is how we are managing, and still we are emerging and managing 24/7. And last but not the least, Madam, I want to tell you, Atu, many have died.
Yes, sir. Truth.
And it is one of the very greatest challenge for us in this COVID time. Nobody wants to touch. You know, last time how a Naga boy was buried in the Chandigarh Sector 25 graveyard. Yes. How we manage, somehow we manage. Here, what we have done is that because for a big hospital, yes, they have the ambulance for dead body. They have a sanitized PP kit, what is called fully protected medical staff to carry the dead body. And if it is Hindu, they cremate them into the Delhi crematorium. If it is Christian or Muslim, they just bury them into Mangalpuri, so on and so forth. But the challenges came when those who are in home quarantine, when they die, or somebody in some temporary COVID quarantine center, if they die, they have no facility for the dead body carriage, ambulance, no one medical staff with a fully protected, sanitized medical staff for the getting dead body. It was the greatest challenge. So what we did, we had a tie-up with our United Sikh Forum. They have an elaborate ambulance, elaborate staff with the police sanitized from head to toe with the PPE kit. So we buried many of our noticed COVID patients who were lying. I give an example. A Mary Combs, one of her known and relative, he died in the Delhi camp in the temporary COVID center of the DRDO. So there was no one to carry them. So they reached me out. By the day, before they reached me out, they desperately tried to book it by, by booking in the, since he was a Hindu from Manipur, tried to book in the crematorium booking in the Nigam Board, most famous, crematorium of Delhi. The list was 147 in waiting list. In 147 means it will take 2 days to wait, another 2 days to cremate the body. So we face a lot of problems. So we immediately chip in. Within 1 hour, we carried the body, our volunteers and 6 units, and did all the cremation as per Hindu rite, since they were what is from the Hindu in the Punjabi Bhaktins. Helping hand has got tie up with the Punjabi Bhaktins where they do it free of post this one. Then it is a Christians, we do it for our people in the, I have two graveyard all the time ready to bury our, one is Sector 23 and Burari and Mangalpuri, also added. So this is how we are taking care of their oxygen, of their blood plasma leaves, then we have our ambulance, we are burying them, and now we are giving even emotional counseling to our people. And even like this sister, Lobby Kali Subi, she died. And there was, unfortunately, there was so much of, I'm not blaming anyone, but point is, in such lockdown time, there's no one whom you can respond.
So also, yes, sir, adding to that, I would also like to, you mentioned in a Facebook post that when it comes to difficult situations like this, we always ask about, which tribe does he or she belongs to. So do you think this throws a light on tribalism, or is it something very common that always happens when things like this occur?
It's very unfortunate, Atu, that because of luckily or unluckily, I always get this SOS call from our people from all over the country.
Yes,
so whenever I try to reach out to many of our tribal leaders or even to our NGO or even to our officers, and that's what I did. The Naga was maximum number they were asking. Whenever they ask you, this girl is found, Naga girl is like, which tribe does she belong? After that, no response. So I think this is something which I am really, we should come out from this mental, which tribe? Yeah? First, you are Naga first. Yeah? Forget about
yes,
it. Forget Naga. Anyone who is in need. If somebody is asking your help, even a ABG level senior officer is asking you, with one Naga girl is found dead, there's no one. Anyone can you help? Who is there? Who can help out? What's the point of asking which tribe do you belong? If it was really repulsive, then I will, through your viewers, I'll tell each and everyone. This is world is become too small, yeah. Now all those tribalism, this community wise, this is over now, yeah. Humanity comes first. So I request all of you, whenever such thing comes, please come out. Please do not say this word of which community does it belong. And it's a fact. Let me, since you have raised this issue, I want to give an example. One of our very well-to-do leader from our northeast. We approached you, that girl has been rescued from the brothel, and she is a teenage girl. Yes. And we want to send her back, and we have some problem for our accommodation, so before she goes back home. So I sent one of our helping and lawyer from the state. That particular gentleman was staying in the Leh Meridian of the our Delhi Post Hotel, where every night is more than around 80,000 rupees plus. So my advocate went there, appraised this, our honorable, one of our leader, telling her, this has happened, and we want to send her back. We need some help.
Yes.
He gave just only 2,500. 2,500. Anyway, I don't expect anyone to come and help you, but only my request is that we all are here on this earth for temporary period.
Yes.
You are lucky enough to be in that position to be elected by people, lucky enough to be in that big post in officer,
yes,
whatever hierarchy you are. you are lucky enough to be in that better position. So I think if you are really a believer of God, if you are really a good human being, I think you should not ask which man does he belong to. Tomorrow it can be your sister, your brother, anyone can be like that, you know?
Yes,
so many cases, I can go on and on, yeah.
So also during these times, I just want to know how supportive or what has been the support from our student union as well, like Naga Student Union and other organizations there, sir.
I'm happy that Naga Student Union, as in, they are many a time they are in constant touch with me. Somewhere or other, I don't know, sometimes I make a joke with them, yeah. Don't you have your own people to at least to call, yeah? You are only assisting, there's no one, yeah. Anyway, that's a different issue. I tell them, look, okay, I'm happy that you are reaching out to me also. But,
yes, sir.
You know, there are people, you know, who appropriate authority also to help you out. Yeah, if it is related to police, your police department, if it is related to women, you have a women and child development minister department, you have a women commission. Then if it is something to do with what is called job related, you have an employment labor department. So somewhere or other, they are in touch with me. I must tell you very honestly, they are in constant touch with me, very, very proactive. But having said that, they need to organize in a better way.
Okay, sir.
Because only reaching out to me, I am not the answer for all problems. I know you are telling me I escalate, I reach out to because I have volunteers all over the country. I inform our volunteers, I inform the police commissioner or SP of the district or the DM of the district. We try to take over the dead body or even try to take over the whoever is in the hospital or in any emergency case. That is there. So I even many times, my advice to the student, I'm happy that Naga student, they are doing well, is that try to have a more robust kind of information flow. One. Two, try to mobilize your own leaders. I'm not asking for money, but at least so that, you know, they can give you support.
Yes, sir.
Then try to rope in that particular department where youths and women are involved. Your Bhavan also. So all these things, I think I get the idea. Why don't you have an annual review meeting of, you know, problem of the Naga students or the employees outside Nagaland annually? I can come there as a guest speaker.
Yes,
yeah. I can give you the data. I can give an idea. So they are doing well, but they need to be more focused, more, I would say, organized way, and have a more robust system of information flow. And they should have somebody in almost in a major city wherever they are. Because I know many of them have constantly personally touch with me from Pune, from Mumbai, from Bangalore, from Jaipur. But NACD of Delhi have no idea of who is there. They have to search out. So you should have a kind of a directory of the Naga student in all over the country, or Naga pastor, which are the very, you know, many of the pastors are all over the country.
Yes,
even
sir.
Officers are there.
Yes,
but
sir.
Here again, I'm not only against, not only about Naga. I want to tell you one very good example. I also go to church.
Yes, sir.
You know, I appeal to our own officers who are in good positions. Look, you were right upon that. We hardly come out from comfort zone. And I feel really like whenever they to come to the place of worship and shout very loudly, they say prayer and sing a song. And when it comes to helping your people, somewhere or other, there is a silence of the grave. I think we are forgetting our own root, our own community,
yes,
on our state. And I think if you are really a God-fearing man, I think we must do whatever you can. Yes, Atu?
Also, sir, when it comes to government, when it comes to issues like this, when it comes to hard times like what we are going through right now, what is the difference between the welfare support and the funds and the relief given by the other northeastern state governments, and what is the difference between Nagaland? Can you say that we are lacking behind? If yes, how?
It won't be appropriate for me to comment what governments are doing, is government, because I am speaking as an NGO or as a, you know,
yes,
who is trying to do beyond the call of duty.
Yes,
but
sir.
I must acknowledge, like, for example, like so far in this hour of emergency, who have given help? I tell you, NEC had given us some money, 30 lakhs. like Alem Tashi Jamil had given, help us some money. Now your women commissioner had given some money, some amount. They had like some of the two MP had given, one gave me 20,000, another gave me 40,000, you know. But 99% of the health and finance and ration, all are from Delhi and from these mainland people only. Because
yes,
they know, they are seeing it on the ground, they need it. So I think we need to do more. My only advice, my appeal will be only we need to reach out more through our donor and NEC and take stock taking of the how do we reach out to this, inverted comma, our abandoned notice people in cities. Yeah, if something
yes, sir,
happens,
so
there's no one.
We can also say that when it comes to these hard times, we are all working on exceeding the oxygen, ventilators, our beds, our hospitals. But when it comes to our people studying outside or living outside, do you think like they are being ignored by the government right now?
No, it's not a question of ignore. Ignore by the That ignore will be a bad word to say that. Maybe they are doing it in their own way, but problem is very massive. And only I can say that we need to have a more, even if you are doing, it should be visible, it should be audible, it should be seen to be doing. And my advice will be take the stakeholders, yeah, like Nagastrin Union, like Helping Hand, like Robin Hibu, those who are on the ground level risking their life and limb. Everybody now, we are risking our life and limb and helping our people even in this dangerous COVID time when nobody is going out. I go to my oxygen ATM every day. I go and our boys reach out, take the oxygen medicine to our people who are stranded in the home. So I think we all need to chip in. And whatever government, I know they have a lot of, we have resources. They can do it more in a more, I would say, taking the stakeholder into the confidence. And in a very visible and in a very concentrated effort in a unified way, so that and it should be known to our people that yes, if there is something to be done for the Naga or Arunachal or Mizo, these are the facilities or these are the schemes, these are the emergency response available with us.
Okay, so sir, we put up a post on our social media pages where we asked our viewers to, ask questions if they have any. And one most common question was that, our people, we want to know what is your plan after retirement? Do you plan on joining politics or do you plan on being a social worker? That was one of the most common questions. So I would like to put forward that, sir.
Look, I have still 8.5 years to go. Yeah, that's a very long time. Yeah, so I think God has been very kind. I joined IPS in a very young age. I'm one of the youngest at this rank, DGP level officer. So still, I have a long way to go. So to me, I'm not doing it for politics or for as well publicity. Yeah, what publicity do I need? I have been to the UN with the president. I have been so many guest postings. I am doing because, as I said in the beginning, I understand the problem. I can see their tears, like my own tears when I was also in their position. Now I am in a better position. So this is not doing for something which for future plan or this and that. So my plan is I'll go on, do this, whatever I can feel my last breath. It is my inner calling.
Okay, sir.
And I'm trying to trying to mobilize, try to sensitize, try to, I would say, ignite this feeling of give back to your society, to our fellow officers, to our leaders, to our social workers, to our people at large, because this world is not our home. We all will go back. So what for you are there if you cannot share a few bread of your loaf or few fish from your plate to your fellow less privileged? Yeah? And that's what I think we all have to carry this cross into this Calvary to till the end of our life. And that's, I'll be continuing doing that. Yes, Atu?
So coming to an end of this conversation, sir, is there anything specific you'd like to bring to the notice of the chief ministers of the northeastern states for the betterment of the people, sir?
I think they are doing their best, and I'm sure they are doing their best. They are planning it out. Only I would just wish that if there can be a meeting or a video conference of this lesson to be learned during the emergency of this emergency like COVID for the people who are outside your state, means not only Nagaland, but all other eight states.
Yes, sir.
We need to have a stock-taking analysis of how can we prepare more the roadmap for future to help our people. That is number one.
Yes,
number two, I think we need to, I would say, appreciate or recognize those people from the mainland who stood for us during our hour of need. I want to hear especially mention the name of, you know, like late this Kuldeep Channa. He was a founder member of the Helping Hand,
yes,
who buried 700 people, collected ration, donated blood, always stood with the notice people.
Yes.
So I think such people need to be honored and remembered by our notice people and by the government.
True,
and also our own people, like, for example, I'm telling you, Dr. Lira from your Nagaland, who, you know, doing such a good job, like Kaling Jamo, like
yes,
even many others who are doing, like Dr. Alana Golmai and others, who are, you know, doing the thankless job 24/7. I think this is the lesson I think we need to learn. And last but not the least, I really wish if we can, I know everybody is pushing on the job, if we can have immediate better road, better air connectivity, I think that will solve out most of our problem.
That will be the solution to almost everything, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So I think that would be a great idea. Yes, Atu?
Okay, so before we end up with this conversation, we'd just like to say that you have our utmost respect and admiration. And also, we believe that even in the future, you will serve our people with the same spirit, sir, and keep inspiring our young generation, sir. Thank you so much for joining us today, sir. It was a very fruitful and a very healthy conversation and a very informative one as well. Thank you so much, sir.
I also thank you to the Hornbill channel that you have taken up very innovative, you know, even for my state and even Sikkim, they all are searching for Hornbill TV. Please keep up this spirit of bring innovativeness and take out those issues which are affecting the voiceless people from the ground. Okay?
Sure,
thank you
sir.
So much.
Sure, sir. We'll
God
do our
bless
best.
Nagaland, and God bless all of you. Yeah.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Sir.
Thank you.